Hi, I'm Marty Nemko. Some people fit easily within societal norms, and life is easier for them. But what if you're not much of a follow-the-crowd person? Here are three composite profiles which present many ways a person might be out of step. Their purpose is to help you inventory the ways that you are and aren't normative, and what, as we enter 2019, you might want to change and not. First, I'll tell you about Jen. Jen is a junior at State U. She spent her first two college years at community college, living at home because she wanted to save her parents money. The quality of teaching is better at community colleges. She didn't feel mature enough to live away from home, and she knew she could get into a more prestigious college later as a transfer student than as a freshman. When, as a senior in high school, Jen told her friends that she was starting at community college, and they gave her the, "How could you do that?" look, she shrugged off their shallow condescension. At State U, while many students were majoring in IT, science, or business, Jen chose theater because she was better at words than numbers, liked it more, and felt that long-term, she'd benefit more from the communication skills and values she'd learned from studying and performing in plays. While she was open to the consistent leftism of professors' lectures, class readings, and the go-along-to-get-along student comments, she also made the effort to seek out the rare conservative professor, and she joined the campus libertarian club, even though she was far from a pure libertarian. Recreationally, Jen rarely went to State U football games and did little partying. She said, "Dancing seems so silly, bouncing your body around for no reason, let alone while buzzed on alcohol or weed. If I want to make a friend, I'd rather do that with thoughtful conversation. Or I'm happy spending lots of time by myself, reading or listening to music, mainly show tunes, and exploring the world using Google search." She dated less than did her peers, agreeing to even a first date only with someone she thought was terrific, not requiring major compromise or a renovation project. She also held those high standards for platonic friendships. Not surprisingly, because of that and her out-of-stepness, Jen spent lots of time alone, and was comfortable enough in her skin to prefer that to lowering her standards. Now I want to tell you about Bob. Bob's neighbors were competitive in moving up the job and income ladder, in playing sports, even in the brand of car they drove. Bob disliked competition, except a bit with himself, for example, challenging himself to learn some software. At social gatherings, he deliberately sought out the not pretty people, knowing they couldn't get by on their looks, so perhaps were more likely to have made the effort to develop a good personality. Besides, it felt virtuous not being lookist. Living in the Napa Valley, everyone drank wine, but he didn't like alcohol's taste, so he usually opted for sparkling water. Bob's neighbors were conspicuously fit, getting to the gym before work, following the diet du jour, for example, keto, gluten-free, quinoa, not potatoes, or vegetarian if not downright vegan. In contrast, Bob ate just moderately, reasonably balanced, occasional cheats, and didn't spend the money on local, organic, sustainable. He thought, "The chances of that improving my health, let alone the planet's, are trivial." Yeah, Bob had gained 10 pounds over the last decade or so, but he wasn't going to obsess about that like his peers did. When Bob's dad died, his friends showered themselves on him and urged him to see a therapist to process it. But when in the first session, the therapist had him create a, quote, memory collage of his dad, he decided he would do better to not dwell on his dad but get back to life, allowing memories of his dad to emerge naturally. Bob was an outsider, out of step, and privately was proud for not being a lemming. And finally, I want to tell you about Laura. Laura had been a counselor at a healthcare organization. While most of her fellow counselors dressed for image, she was frumpy and viewed, quote, real jewelry as a waste of money. In the break room, while some of the counselors spent considerable time male bashing, she actually liked most men and couldn't understand why they and the media disproportionately portray men as jerks or clueless, shown the way by a woman, and that even still pictures were usually of women, except if portraying a loser. Laura found herself out of step in other ways. Counselors self-righteously proclaimed the importance of expanding transgender rights. Laura didn't have the guts to dissent, but privately thought, "That tiny group is getting an awful lot of attention. There are far more pervasive problems that deserve our attention, certainly bigger problems than which bathroom transgendered should use." On retiring, Laura did the standard good liberal thing she volunteered, trying to teach illiterate adults to read, but soon quit, frustrated with the slow progress. She said, I'll make a bigger difference by reading to and with my grandkids. The takeaway? Many people feel great pressure to fit in, even if it eats away at the self they would rather be. In light of the above three profiles, as we enter 2019, do you want to make any changes in yourself or to accept yourself more? Thank you for watching and perhaps sharing if you deem it appropriate. I'm Marty Nemko.